Greetings, fellow nerds. It's time for the December question and answer video, and we have a lot of them this month. First, big shout outs to our newest big sponsor this month on Patreon. There is only one, Jack Kelly. Thank you very much for your contributions. I hope you're not my last big sponsor. Okay, so let's get to the questions. Bobby Nansel asks, pretty much how to make polymers using readily available chemicals. Okay, well, that can be incredibly easy or incredibly hard, depending on how much work you want to do. A lot of plastics can simply be melted and molded into new shapes. The glue in a hot glue gun, for example, is a plastic specially made for remelting and adhesive use. Now, I grant you that melting plastics is cheating when it comes to making polymers. An actual easy-to-make polymer is cyanoacrylate, which is the main component of super glue or crazy glue, depending on the brand name. The glue consists of liquid cyanoacrylate monomers that polymerize into polycyanoacrylate upon exposure to air. The rapid hardening of such glue is actually the formation of a polymer, so you're making polymers every time you use that glue. Actually, you know, come to think of it, a lot of glues and adhesives are polymers. In particular, adhesives that are two-part formulations like epoxy are separately chemical monomers that combine to polymerize into polymers. I recommend researching those to understand their formulations. Most of them are pretty easy to buy without restriction. As for your core question of how to make the monomers at home without cheating and buying glue components, and then initiating polymerization, I'm not sure I can help you, sorry. The organic chemicals that most polymers consist of are difficult to produce, and the intermediates and other chemicals to make them are usually dangerous and toxic to work with. However, I will look into it and maybe come back to this in the future. Okay, Matthew Sachs asks, I enjoyed your video concerning using zeolite or magnesium to dry a solvent. If I did this to ethanol, would the end product be food safe in either instance? Most molecular sieves are made to industrial specifications, thus they are not food safe. You need to find molecular sieves that are made to food grade specifications. Even then, molecular sieves tend to shed molecular sieve dust. This stuff is essentially an artificial clay, so you'll have clay dust in your product. If you're okay with tasting that, then go for it. Jean-Francois Perriot asks, and I'm sorry if I'm pronouncing your name wrong, how to make the efficient water electrolysis rig using only stuff from the hardware store? I don't really know. Hardware store materials tend to be lacking. The old standby is to go with nickel anodes and iron cathodes in a strongly alkaline solution like sodium hydroxide drain cleaner. But keep in mind that regardless of design, efficiency tends to increase the lower the current density you go. So decrease the current for more efficiency. But since the rate of production also decreases, you reach a point where you have to balance the rate against the efficiency. You can build bigger and greater numbers of electrolytic cells to multiply your overall rate, but then you have the problem of cost. To explore all these issues of cost versus rate versus efficiency would require at least a full video. So I'm going to stop here, but there are huge numbers of videos on the subject by other YouTubers. You might get some good ideas with a bit of searching. Okay, moving on. Keith asks, glass panels break when they bend. Why are glass fibers flexible? Wow, this is one of those questions that sounds simple, but is much more difficult when you get into it. Now, in any piece of glass, there are defects like microscopic cracks, dislocations, and so on. Glass breaks when you apply enough stress that the defects propagate through the glass and ultimately cause it to fail. Now, with a piece of bulk glass, as you bend it, you create a side of high compression and the opposite is under high tension. The micro cracks on the side with high tension are under enough stress that they eventually break the glass. In a very thin piece of glass, like a strand of optical fiber, when you bend it, there isn't enough of a cross-sectional area for the forces to build against to create the extreme compression and tension stresses. So the whole fiber can bend without breaking. But up to a point, eventually with enough bending, you will break the fiber. Okay, moving on. Colin Wright asks, any nerdy tips in home chemistry to make the holidays a little bit more jolly? Red and green dyes, festive holiday ideas, etc. Happy holidays, Nerdish family. Okay, well, happy holidays to you too. As for ideas, sorry, I got nothing. The closest thing I got may be flaming candy canes oxidized by potassium chlorate. Okay, next question. Roger asks, what makes certain things spontaneously combustible? For example, a lot of organometallics will burn vigorously when exposed to air. Okay, things combust when their temperature is above the activation energy for combustion. In something like paper, the activation energy is well above room temperature, so they don't catch fire until you heat them up a lot with a flame. Then they start burning. For very reactive chemicals like diethyl zinc, the activation energy is below room temperature, so they spontaneously ignite. This property of igniting spontaneously in air and ambient conditions is called pyrophoricity. Now, if you cooled these things to very low temperatures, then they would no longer spontaneously combust. Okay, moving on, Jason Black asks, what's going on in those rechargeable hand warmers that you boil to recharge? Since the chemical in them clearly can be solid at room temperature, why don't they spontaneously freeze when they cool down after being recharged? What keeps them liquid until you activate them? Well, you're in luck. Way back in 2009, I actually made a few videos on the substance called sodium acetate trihydrate, or more commonly known as hot ice. Basically, when you heat up the sodium acetate trihydrate, it melts into a liquid. Now, this substance has a useful property in that it's very easy to cool it back down well below its melting point, but still keep it in a liquid state. This process is called supercooling. They're in an unstable state, and if a nucleation source is introduced, like clicking the metal disc inside the hand warmer, they'll spontaneously crystallize back into the solid state. This crystallization releases heat, the same heat that went into melting them in the first place. And that's basically how it works. The great thing about them is that the process is physical and there is no chemical change, so it can be recharged by heating them up again until they melt. I'll put a few links in the video description to my old videos. Be warned though, they are from when I just started on YouTube, so the quality is, not up to my modern standards. Maybe I'll redo them if there's enough interest. Next question, Stuart wants to know, would you ever consider making a video on something like a membraneless hydrobromic acid flow battery? I'll certainly consider it, not sure if I'll actually do it though. But the membraneless flow battery is very interesting, so I'll seriously consider it. Okay, next question, Ben Larson asks, would you consider making a video on concentrating 3% over-the-counter hydrogen peroxide to 30% or so? Where I live, I find it impossible to acquire high concentration hydrogen peroxide anywhere, thanks, love your videos. Okay. Concentrating hydrogen peroxide is definitely on the list of things to do. But one of the important things I need to first demonstrate is a means of testing the hydrogen peroxide to determine just how concentrated it is. This way we can figure out if our concentration technique is working or not. Now, with so many ideas for videos in the pipeline, I'm not sure when I'll get around to it, but I do eventually want to do it. Okay, next question. Alex asks, there are a ton of videos of batteries blowing up when punctured. What is the chemical reaction that is happening to cause such a reaction? There is no specific chemical reaction, it's just that a well-designed battery has a lot of energy packed into it. If you put a screwdriver across the terminals of a car battery, it would also explode. But don't actually do that though, that's extremely dangerous. Anyway, sometimes the battery packs are badly designed and the contacts between the batteries might touch the metal case or another battery in a different orientation. This can lead to failures regardless of battery type. Now, lithium batteries are known for exploding much more than other types. What makes modern lithium batteries so susceptible to this is that the internal components are usually made into a sandwich that's rolled up and packed into the container. Now, this sandwich must be perfect throughout or you'll get contact between the positive layer and the negative layer. Occasionally, when making millions of these batteries, there might be a defect in the layers that isn't detected at the factory and the battery gets shipped out with it. If some random event occurs, like shaking the battery or overcharging it, then the defect can result in failure of the layers and contact between them occurs. If you puncture a battery, you force the layers into contact, and that essentially does the same thing. Now the fun stuff happens. All that power in the battery is short-circuited across that tiny little defect or puncture hole, and that part of the battery melts. But this makes it even worse because the molten battery components are actually somewhat conductive. So now more of the energy gets dumped into that molten region as all the current rushes toward the point of highest conductivity. This in turn melts more of the battery and heats out the rest of the battery. This whole process happens very quickly and the battery can rupture, spraying its molten contents outside. Now lithium batteries do not use water-based chemistry. They can't since the components react with water. Instead, they use organic solvents and electrolytes which also happen to be highly flammable. Now if you have a rupturing battery spitting out highly flammable chemicals at high temperatures, then you have a very good chance of ignition, and most batteries do indeed catch fire, so it looks like they're exploding. And that's what happens when a lithium battery fails. A lot of YouTube videos induce failure by deforming the battery or by hammering them with a nail or puncturing them, and or crushing them. Once you have contact between the internal layers of the battery, then the failure occurs. Hope that answers your question. Okay, Jack Kelly asks, what would be some good books for an amateur chemist with experiments as well as explanations behind the science? much like your episodes, but in text format? To be honest, I don't know. I would have killed for a good book like that when I was young. Maybe I'll write one someday. But anyway, I'm sure lots of my viewers know of good books, so I put the question to everyone and hope that we can come to some replies in the comments. Okay, next question. Michelle Alnazzi asks, hydrofluoric acid. One, can you explain its ability of dissolving glass? How? Two, can we prepare it in the laboratory? How? And three, main uses of hydrofluoric acid. Okay, hydrofluoric acid reacts with silicon dioxide in glass to form silicon tetrafluoride and hydrofluorosilic acid. Now the reason why this happens is because the silicon fluoride bond is actually stronger than the silicon oxygen bond. This is why hydrofluoric acid is best handled in plastic, Teflon, or very specially prepared metal containers and not in glass. It's made in the laboratory by reacting calcium fluoride with concentrated sulfuric acid. Early chemists used containers and apparatus made of lead to handle the hydrofluoric acid. Its main use is the production of organofluorine compounds. Major examples include PTFE or Teflon cookware. Additionally, a lot of refrigerants use organofluorine compounds. Okay, last question. Ray asks, can a 40 psi diaphragm vacuum pump be used to efficiently distill white fuming nitric acid? And if it works, will one gas trap be adequate to protect the pump from the corrosive gases? I have no idea. I haven't distilled white fuming nitric acid to say what conditions are most efficient. 40 psi, or 40 pounds per square inch, sounds like the level of compression that the pump gives. It does not sound like the level of the vacuum. This is because atmospheric pressure is 14.7 psi. It's impossible to deduct 40 psi from that and end up with a negative absolute pressure. Look at your pump specifications for something called ultimate vacuum, which should be the lowest pressure it can attain. Okay, so that's it for the questions for this December. Thanks for watching, and as usual, you know, December being in the spirit of giving, I ask you all to give to a wonderful and very needy charity, me. My Patreon account is still there, and I've included links in the video description. Hopefully I'll have another video before the end of the year, and we'll see what happens next year.